So thank you very much. Today, we are hearing increasingly talk of a new Cold War and calls for a new European security architecture. So is this true? My view is that these conclusions are perhaps questionable. There is a return of geopolitics, that's obvious. But then today's world is fundamentally different from that of the Cold War, because we're living in a multipolar, increasingly complex environment with many more actors involved, including non-state movements and groups that seek to exploit the divisions related to geopolitics. At the same time, we see in Europe a multiplicity of security challenges emerging. Of course, instability, armed conflict, both within our region and in our larger neighborhood, are affecting our security. And we see also hybrid forms of warfare that forced us also to relook the tools that we have to address the problems. We have seen an upsurge in terrorism and in violent extremism, growth of transnational threats, including organized crime and trafficking in drugs, in crime, in persons. We've seen a massive influx of refugees and migrants on an unprecedented scale. And then, of course, we have global challenges, from climate change to demographic pressures, increasing economic disparities within and between countries and regions, all factors that increasingly have an impact on security. And in reaction to some of these challenges, we also see a worrying growth in populist, nationalist, even xenophobic rhetoric, creating rifts within our societies that could erupt into violence, in that case, generate instability. So we have an extremely complex menu of challenges in front of us. And because of the complexity and because of the interconnections between these challenges, we see the need to change the way we address our security. It is a time when we need global solutions, we need to build coalitions, we need to strengthen cooperation and coordination. And of course, at a time when there is an increasing polarization and when, as I said, geopolitics are returning, this is becoming increasingly difficult to do. We see in the OSCE different perceptions and diverging interpretation of fundamental principles that are governing the relations between countries, and these are undermining our capacity to seek common approaches. We have had important achievements in key areas of European security, from arms control to crisis prevention, conflict resolution, but there is a debate about the interpretation of the key principles adopted in Helsinki, and the crisis in and around Ukraine is only the latest incarnation of this deeper malaise. We see completely different narratives emerging and diverging perspectives about the crisis and about the origins of the crisis, which are fueling mistrust and tension. And we see increasing pressure for militarized responses. And this obviously would only increase the risk of escalation with a potential negative impact on other protracted conflicts in the OSCE region and beyond. So a worrying picture. The hybrid nature of the crisis has shown also the limit of traditional crisis management tools. And this points to the need to rethink our crisis management approach, but also our confidence building approach and adjust them to this more complex environment. We need to look for new ways to reduce tension and to prevent crises or even inadvertent incidents from turning into conflict. Only last month in the OSCE, we have agreed a decision adopted by consensus by all OSCE countries to introduce a consultation mechanism for cyber attacks. And one of the aims is to mitigate attacks on critical infrastructure that could affect more than one state. And this shows that we can achieve consensus on important issues even at a time when tensions are high. And I think this should prod us to think where we can find in a restricted space, if you want, within which we manage to operate because of geopolitics. But we need to find those areas where we have a convergence of interest and build on those to recreate a climate of trust and a climate of confidence that would allow us to make further progress. We could, and there are ideas that could be considered. For instance, establishing a neutral mechanism for military fact-finding or inspections under an OSCE flag rather than sending national inspectors. a centralized or institutionalized OSCE verification or inspection mechanism, which could be modeled along mechanisms used by the CTBTO, the Atomic Agency, or the Chemical Weapons Organization, and could draw on either a pool of national experts or staff that is assigned to the organization. And this would allow allow us to avoid the politicization of these activities, and would allow us to avoid being caught in the politics around the conflict situation. The OSCE could also provide an inclusive platform for dealing with hazardous military encounters. We already have a history of negotiations on arms control, so we could consider using the organization to enable the countries to cooperate bilaterally or regionally or sub-regionally by putting in place agreements aimed at preventing escalation that could result from such encounters. And these agreements could include procedures to clarify the situation when encounters occur, follow-up actions to investigate them, and this could be one way to utilize institutionalized military relations. We could also consider compartmentalizing discussions on arms control in the OSCE area to enable progress on issues where common understanding is possible. Of course, the bottom line has to be the recognition that there are divergent security perceptions, divergent security interests, and we need to find that common ground where everybody feels that progress is own, is also in its own interest. So identifying in an impartial manner and in a neutral manner those areas where we can make progress to the benefit of everybody is key. At the end of the day, to reconsolidate security, we must replace the current culture of confrontation, which is unfortunately emerging, with one of cooperation and joint action. And for this, the precondition is to keep dialogue and channels of communication open. Above all, I would say, and this is the priority also in my job, we need to work hard to achieve a durable and peaceful settlement of the crisis in and around Ukraine. Because this is a crucial first step needed to bridge the East-West divide and reconfirm the fundamental principles and rules that make international relations more structured and predictable. And this can only be achieved through a careful balancing of strength and multilateralism and traditional political leadership. But then, of course, it is also the ultimate responsibility, and we need to acknowledge that, that lies with the local actors. If they fail, then we all fail. The complexity of these challenges shows that rebuilding security in Europe will only be possible through a persistent and coordinated approach that involves a host of different actors, including international regional organizations, working in flexible and creative coalitions and guided by strong and far-sighted political leadership. In the OSCE, we are building broad and strategic partnerships, even engaging with Mediterranean and Asian partners with whom we increasingly share common concerns, because we do recognize that our security challenges are increasingly interrelated. But we also need to learn to engage in a different way, moving beyond purely intergovernmental dynamics, beyond foreign and defense ministries, engaging civil society, young people, the media, academia, forging coalitions with less traditional partners like the corporated, even the philanthropic sectors and international financial institutions. We have started doing this in the OSCE through the Security Days Conference and a network of think tanks and academic institutions. Towards the end of June, I will convene a Security Days Conference in Berlin to encourage an open and informal dialogue on how we can revive cooperative security in the OSCE region. I'm convinced that we do not need new security structures or formats in Europe. What we do need now is to revitalize what we already have, adapt them to contemporary challenges, and most important, renew our efforts and our commitment to European security as a common project. We can find inspiration in the OSCE experience 40 years ago. Despite the stark divisions at the time and the real risk of failure, our leaders mastered the courage to work together to develop a shared vision and create the foundation of a security system that served us well for decades, but is now in jeopardy. We need the same kind of courage and visionary political leadership today to restore the confidence and trust needed to navigate the troubled waters ahead of us. No matter how deep are perceived disagreements, a return to the zero-sum logic would serve no one well. We face common security challenges, so we have to engage with each other in open and frank dialogue and find ways to tackle our shared challenges together. Although it will take time and patience and perseverance to reinvigorate the vision of a common future, European security is and must remain a common project. Thank you.